Well, we begin our meditation on God's word in the name of Jesus. As grace, mercy, and peace be to you, dear Christians, to you who love Jesus, and to you who love to tell the story of Jesus. Well, before us today, we have the first four verses of Luke's gospel. It's sometimes called the prologue to Luke's gospel. If you're on Facebook these past few days and you saw my little riddle, well, here's the answer. Now, I had the beginning words that scroll in the Star Wars movies, you know, those words that come at the beginning. That's the prologue to Star Wars. And so I bet everyone, if you could guess the sermon text, you get the Luther bobblehead free, but I didn't get anybody guessing. This was a pretty hard riddle, though, unless you knew that that was meant to be the prologue. And then the little word Luke was highlighted, so it was supposed to be Luke and the beginning verses of Luke, which are called the prologue, verses 1 through 4. Nobody wins the bobblehead this year. I know, everybody, don't start throwing things at me. It was a very hard riddle. Everybody got mad at Samson, too, when he laid out a riddle for people that no one could solve. But it was fun. And I wanted to keep my Luther bobblehead anyway, so I get to keep my Luther bobblehead. Have you ever spent any time, when was the last time you spent time looking at the beginning verses of Luke? Sometimes we kind of pass over those first verses and try to get on to the rest, you know. Kind of like with the book of Matthew, where it opens with all those names, one name after the other. It's a list of names that are hard to pronounce. But if you slow down and you look at all of those begats and begottens, there's a lot of gems in there. In Matthew's opening list, he's showing that the holy Savior Jesus was willing to include unholy sinners in his family tree. He came to be the Savior of all. And there are a lot of gems. If we take our time and look at the beginning verses of Luke today, we'll see there's a lot here that will benefit us, much of great value. So as we turn to the prologue of Luke the Evangelist and his gospel, let's have the theme of our hymn in mind today. I love to tell the story of Jesus and his love. You saw that in Luke's life. He certainly was one who loved Jesus, and we'll see he's certainly one who loved all. So who was Luke, that writer of the third gospel, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. We don't know much about Luke. We know a few things. For instance, his name, Luke, literally means belonging to the light. Although we don't know when or how he came to know the only true light, Jesus. He is mentioned at the end of Paul's letter to the Colossians this way. At the end of his letter, he's writing a bunch of greetings, like so-and-so greets you from the Church of Colossae, and everyone was supposed to read about these people's greeting. Our dear friend Luke also greets, you know, the doctor he's called. So we surmise that Luke must have been well-learned, intelligent, if he was a doctor of medicine. Again, we don't know much more than that, though. Nothing else is mentioned about him practicing medicine. He doesn't use a lot of healing terminology, medical terminology, in his Gospels either. We do know also that he was a companion of the Apostle Paul and went with him on some of his missionary journeys. So when Luke is writing about those journeys in the book of Acts, you know he was a companion because he'll go from one chapter and verse where he's using the third person singular, and he says he, that is Paul, was going here or there or doing this or that. And then in the next section, he'll all of a sudden switch to first person plural and say we were going here and there and doing this or that. So you know he was with them. He's writing about things that happened when they were together. And we know that Luke remained with Paul all the way on those journeys until the very end, right up to the time where he was martyred in Rome. Luke was there. So it sounds like he's the kind of loyal and trustworthy companion that we'd like as a friend and to have on our sides too in life. But above all, Luke was someone who loved Jesus. And that's the most important thing we want to know about Luke. He loved his Savior Jesus. And how do we know that? Well, you can tell from his prologue. He wanted to share all that he could about that Savior he loved with an acquaintance of his that he refers to as Theophilus. Said, Theophilus, I love Jesus and I want you to know and learn all about him too. And he says there's a reason for this, Theophilus, that you might know the certainty of the things you have been taught. So he wants to tell Theophilus about Jesus. Tell him some more about this Savior he loves. Perhaps Theophilus was in one of his Bible instruction classes. We don't know. The name Theophilus itself means lover of God. Theos from the Greek for God and philia, the word, Greek word for love. He's a lover of God. He loves God. Not sure if that was Theophilus' original name. Sometimes when Greek converts to Christianity were confirmed and baptized, they received a new Christian name. So maybe Theophilus was his new given name as a Christian. But that's why Luke writes his gospel. This is one reason. I want you to know, Theophilus, about the Savior I love. But he also wrote for others, didn't he? Not just Theophilus. He writes for others still today. Like Miguel. You don't know Miguel, but Miguel is one of my father's friends from his jail ministry. He came to be a part of my dad's jail Bible class and learn more about his Savior there too. The thing that's interesting about Miguel is that he came from a rough and tumble background. He had gotten into some gang-related, drug-related charges, and that's what landed him in jail. But like a lot of other guys in his circumstances, he didn't know how to read or write. Somehow he got through school without being able to read or write anything. And yet, you know how Miguel learned to... I see you. You know how Miguel learned how to read? Take a wild guess. From a Bible. He had his ABCs, but that was about it. But he would take and he'd just take a short verse and he'd spend time putting the letters together and words together until he got a sentence or a verse. And then he'd go over that verse again for its meaning. And he'd do that slowly, meticulously. And as he was, God was planting that deep and firm knowledge and love of his Savior in Miguel's heart. And that love for his Savior grew as my dad continued to open up the scriptures to him in their Bible class together. It's kind of interesting. When he was in my dad's Bible class, he would remind all of the guys in the class of the need to read their Bibles every day, he said. It's so important. And Miguel put it this way. He said, our brains, they're like a computer that needs daily updating. And so you don't want your system, that is your brain, to get all corrupted by sin and Satan's viruses. So you need to daily download the scriptures, the Holy Scriptures, into your mind to get the Spirit's upgrade, again, into your spiritual software in your brain. He had a lot of ways to put things. It got to the point where my dad called them Miguelisms. Just because he had a neat way of saying things. Another time in my dad's class, they were discussing how guys can be a positive influence among their old friends, you know, because there's always a danger when you're hanging out in the old neighborhood with all those guys who get into trouble. So Miguel said, no way, I ain't going to give up my home court advantage. When I run into them on the street, I'm going to get them on my home court. And so I invite them to church. Yeah, that's why Luke wrote his gospel, didn't he? He wanted others to know about that Savior Jesus who loves us so much. He's writing because he loves Jesus and he wants Theophilus to know more about his Savior. And that's why we're all gathered here today, isn't it? Yes, Luke wrote not only for Theophilus, but for all of us, for all the world. Reading his gospel, we quickly catch his concern to present Jesus as the Savior for all people. Whether you're a high official or an outcast, whether you're rich or poor, Jew or Gentile, man, woman, or child, he wrote to present a Savior so that everyone could say, "He's my Savior." Boy, think of all that we would miss if the Holy Spirit hadn't moved Luke the evangelist to write his gospel. Think about it. I mean, for starters, the gospel of Luke is a big book. And the book of Acts that Luke wrote also is a big book. So we'd be missing about a third of the New Testament. Yes, in the book of Acts, for example, too, a lot of places Luke gives us the voice of Paul, too, as he records all his travels and teaching. We wouldn't have things like the account of Paul's conversion in Acts chapter 9. We'd have that big gap also of not knowing anything about the history of the whole early Christian church. Then also, think of how we'd be missing that Christmas gospel, Luke chapter 2. How beautiful it is when we review that account of Jesus' birth every year at Christmas time. Think of the power in that presentation of the incarnation of Christ. That's so instrumental in understanding God himself and how he deigns to be and come into this world, not as a fearful judge, but as a tiny little baby who grows up to be a man and to save us. Think of all of the post-resurrection appearances that Luke records. Unique to his gospel is that trip of the Emmaus disciples. Remember them, how they were just walking slow, shuffling their feet on Easter Sunday with their heads down low, thinking Jesus was still dead. And Luke records how Jesus showed himself to them, how he opened the minds of the disciples so they could understand his words. In Luke's gospel, we have all kinds of parables, too, unique to his gospel, like the parable of the lost coin, or the parable of the lost sheep, or the lost son, showing us how Jesus has a love for each and every soul, and he's concerned when they are straying or get away or are lost. We have the account of that adulterous woman who had been living a life that sinned against God's sixth commandment, whose shadowy past, though, left her so grateful for Jesus and his forgiveness that she literally washed Jesus' feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. We learn of Jesus' loving and forgiving dealings with the tax collector Zacchaeus. Remember Zacchaeus, who climbed the tree because he just had to see Jesus over the crowds? And then we have that powerful, sweet summary of why Jesus came. When he was at Zacchaeus' house and the Pharisees said, "Why are you eating with tax collectors and sinners?" And Jesus said, "Well, the Son of Man came to seek and to save what was lost." In Luke's gospel, we have Jesus coming into Jerusalem and weeping over that city that, for the most part, had rejected him as the Messiah. Finally, at the end of his account, we have that promise that he gave to the thief on the cross. It's unique to Luke's gospel. The thief turned to Jesus, "Remember," and he said, "Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom." And Jesus said, "Truly I tell you, today you will be with me in paradise." Yes, we'd be missing a lot if we didn't have Luke's gospel. But everywhere you go in that book, you see the Savior's love for all kinds of people from every walk of life. It's no wonder that the Holy Spirit also used Luke to write the book of Acts also to show how the Savior's love through the church went out to the entire world. Yes, we are his witnesses. And of course, Luke's work, it isn't complete, is it? Until all of the elect are gathered in. It's not complete until you and I come to know and love our Savior personally. Yes, praise God that he did move Luke to tell of Jesus, that great friend of sinners and the Redeemer of the lost. And praise God that that message has come down through the corridor of time to reach your soul and mine. Yes, thank God that he sent his Spirit into our hearts so that we may also say with faith, he is my Savior. And let's pray together that God would continue to increase our zeal, not only to love Jesus, but to tell others about his love as well. God grant this for Jesus' sake. Amen. Now may the peace of God, which goes beyond all human understanding, continue to guard and keep our hearts and minds in faith in Christ Jesus. Amen. Be seated as we bring forward our thank offerings to the Lord.